here with Jacob Nykum, who is going to teach us about using GTID-based replication for MySQL high availability. Thank you so much for speaking.
You're welcome. In my presentation, I'm going to talk about both things, about high availability and GTID-based replication. So for introduction, I'm going to talk about basic high availability. Actually, I didn't know exactly how many people and what kind of level of people are going to come. That is why I kind of kept a little bit basic level of discussion, at least about high availability. So in the first section, I'm talking about high availability in general terms and how it relates, how to achieve it, like different solutions. And in the second section, I'm talking about replication as the most popular high availability solution. And in the third, I'm trying to show what is the difference between normal replication or coordinate-based replication and the GTID-based replication. Because it was a major step forward, I believe, GTID-based replication. It is not only just for replication, but I think it is also kind of different direction, trying essentially to create catalog of database transaction in compact way. That's what GTID is trying to do, and I think they do that relatively successfully. So in the third section, I will talk about coordinate replication in quite a bit of details. I think it is useful, you know, because people still use it quite a lot. And it really helpful for GTID as well. So in the fourth, I am going to talk about GTID and show what is the difference, why we need it, and how we get into that. And at the end, in the last section, I show my demo, which is Amazon cloud-based HA architecture. I'm not going to show everything what is related to that, because it will be really quite complex. Even in this simplified version, it is not simple, because we have three servers and also application running in another node. Even in the simplified version, you will see all major points which I would like to make, that using GTID replication, it is much easier to work with. And probably you can do some things which you really cannot do easily with coordinate replication at all. That's my point. So my first slide will be related to high availability, HA. And this definition, according to one book which I found on the net, just devoted directly for the service availability. So availability of this service is a percentage of the time when the system is able to provide that service. Very simple. So when we're talking about high availability, we mean something close to 100% of the time where the service is available. And for the data centers, high availability usually means that you have guaranteed throughput, so number of transactions per second in the your service level agreement is a setup, and you try not to be lower than that. Also, it guarantees response time, which means latency, which is very important for many applications. And you, of course, guarantee uptime and downtime per year, usually in percentiles or second, minutes, and hours. And after that, I'm talking about some definitions. I don't know, mostly I wrote it for people who are not very familiar with vocabulary. In the next slide, I'm talking about a distinction between close but still different notions, like high availability versus continuous availability. And continuously available system does not allow planned outages, essentially supporting no downtime operation. And that's not easy to achieve, really. It is quite outstanding if you can do that. In many cases, highly available system is acceptable. And the difference between high availability and the fault tolerance usually people talk about fault-tolerant system, they assume that there is no service interruption if component fails. So system kind of accept not functioning components or not well-functioning components. And highly available system instead has minimal interruption. What it means that the fault-tolerant system probably costs significantly more than highly available. And highly available system essentially provides sufficient service with the lower cost, with a fixed essentially cost of the system, you get maximum availability. And why we're so interested in high availability? And this is the answer. I think this is the company's worst nightmare scenario. And this is a piece from New York Times. That's what companies really don't like when New York Times cite them. And it was August 19, Amazon.com went down on Monday for many users across United States and Canada, and Amazon didn't respond to requests for comments. What is interesting that just at that day I was at Seattle, just in Amazon, and I definitely felt not pleasant mood among people over there. The downtime was 40 minutes, and I will talk about that a little bit further. What causes data center service downtime? System failures, hardware faults, software bugs or crashes, physical disasters, which actually does happen, scheduled maintenance, that is much better, and of course user errors. And it's interesting that Baron Schwartz wrote a paper about different downtime causes for MySQL particular. And he kind of classified it in four groups: operating environment, performance, exactly replication, and data loss and corruption. And operating environment is the largest one, but replication has a healthy 20% of problems. And what are the system downtime effect and impact? Effect, yeah, service unavailability, bad response time. Sometimes service is available, but it is so slow, people don't like it. But impact is quite obvious: revenue loss, poor customer relations, people don't like, users don't like slow working websites, reduced employees' productivity because they have to change bugs, don't sleep, and all of those nice things, and in worst case, regulatory issues. There are different levels of high availability. Usually it measures in the number of nines. And if you have one nine, usually 90% of availability, you essentially have a luxury of 36 days per year, so your website would be unavailable. The highest is 6 nines, which is essentially half minute per year. It's not easy to get that goal, but why people use that those levels? Because it is very easy to calculate losses. And here another example, how to calculate losses for the company in case of unavailability. And here you see that Amazon makes about $100,000 per minute. So if you, like 40 minutes in August, didn't have connection to the site, you lost obvious number of that. That's why people kind of interested in high availability. It is interesting that failure was done by one mistake or one new person. So how to achieve a necessary level of high availability? There are two ways only how to do that. You can increase the reliability of each component, make them as reliable as possible, or added a new additional redundant component. And it's interesting that the first way is much less efficient. The reliability of the system will be lower than the reliability of any individual component. But the second way is more efficient because you're essentially adding another component, you're adding them in parallel. So the reliability of the system will be higher than the reliability of any individual component. And one of the important things to achieve high availability is to remove single point of failures. The component, when it breaks, the system stops to work. Depending on the different component, people, engineers essentially use different strategies how to remove that. Like for storage, they do RAID. If one disk crashes, the servers, the service still works. Servers, they do clustering, parallelizing the servers. Power supply, UPS, network, you have redundant routers. In locations on the site level, you essentially do another data center, but in this case, you have to use replication. And that's how replication comes into play. What is interesting, that depends on the software you're dealing with. Why high availability with databases is so hard? And that's what people really discuss, comparing with web servers, for example. And there are strong reasons for that. I remember one blog, I think Baron Schwartz as well, why it is so difficult comparing with, again, web servers. Because I thought the databases are essentially real-time systems. Nobody kind of look at databases as for real-time systems, but they do because they react on what happens in real time. They repair problems on fly. They change their parameters on fly depending on conditions on data or in hardware. And moreover, they are even distributed. And that type of systems are traditionally very difficult to deal with. Second, because real-time functionality, caches and dirty data logging, it's real-time. We know that. There is a tight coupling between software and hardware components. What it means that if you want redundant software, you have to bring redundant hardware as well. With the web servers, you just install another server, even on that particular node, and it works. With databases, it's much more difficult. And also, there is another problem, like requirements of real-time consistency between data stored in redundant components. So it means that you continuously, instantaneously have to synchronize, and this is a pain in the neck. That is kind of why databases are difficult, because some people don't believe in that. So here I'm kind of coming closer to MySQL and Oracle. And Oracle, MySQL at Oracle, uses essentially three major technology for high availability. Mostly I'm talking about Linux-based technologies. Oracle now has a Windows-based high availability solution. But I'm talking about Linux. And essentially we have, they have MySQL replication, DRBD, and NDB cluster. They all of them actually perform quite well, but they have differences, and most important difference in availability level. And I'm talking about MySQL replication at the level of 5.5, before 5.6, and it is only three nines. And other DRBD is higher, and DB cluster even higher. But we know that for every advantage, any technology has another disadvantage, like side effect. And all of those technologies have different balance of that. And here, there are advantages and disadvantages. What is interesting that MySQL replication is the most convenient solution because it's in some way easiest to implement. And of course, people go for that. So the obvious idea, why not to just increase MySQL replication availability? And that's what essentially Oracle done. In the latest 5.6 release, they significantly improved their replication technology and make it significantly better. And I believe, I didn't see the numbers, but I believe at least another nine they added to that. And here, just for interest, brief history of MySQL replication and what features have been done. And you can see that replication stood with MySQL for quite a while, 2001, 323, yes, you can see how number of features grow, and you can see in 5.6, significant number of new features have been introduced, and that was really nice. And also, I even show you 5.7, kind of, you can look forward a little bit and see what now they added. And I believe lossless semi-synchronous replication is really good. They finally made semi-synchronous as it should be. That's nice. They improved the utilities, so it is good. This is a list of enhancements in 5.6. And the color actually shows something what I have done. I'm mostly going to talk about global transaction identifiers, GTIDs, server USDs. I use in my demo crash safe, slave, and binary logs. But not going to talk about that. It's a huge presentation. I apologize for that. I'm not going to talk about replication failover and administration utilities. I'm going to talk about failover, but not about utilities which allow people to automate it, because in our work, in the company where I work, we don't use those utilities. I found they are good utilities, but it is not easy sometimes to build them into existing software, what you already have. It's sometimes easier to implement your own scripts using, you know, basic Linux things and just put it, that stuff in. But you can see quite a bit of interesting features. Replication event checksum. I will talk a little bit about that. It is one of the most transparent new features in MySQL 5.6 replication. If we will have a time, I will talk about other features as well. I think this is, I would call it, one of the central slides of the whole presentation. I spent a lot of time preparing that. And here I describe how coordinated replication works. There are not too many good diagrams how MySQL replication works. Most of them are too high. You really don't see important things over there. Some of them too low, so you really see only trees and you don't see the forest. The best one I saw from Giuseppe Maxia. He had wonderful diagram, and they kind of use a little bit of his ideas. Now you see you have master. Of course, you have to have a master if you're talking about replication. And once you have a master, in order to have replication, you have to enable binary log on the master. And we're talking about binary logs. We have multiple of files, essentially like multiple segments of one binary log. And the another file which contains pointers or names to those segments of binary log. And that is called binary log index file. So now, if we want to have replication, we of course need client who's supposed to run some query and run query committed to the master. And master executes that query. And after execution, after essentially commitment, it places that binary query into binary log. I'm currently talking about statement-based replication. With replication, you have three modes how to move data from the master to the slave. You can do that by passing to the slave SQL statements and execute SQL statements on the slave. There is another mode. You can actually pass data to the slave from the master, just rows of the in the tables. And that's where you push data from master to the slave. And the third mode is just mixture of that. And MySQL could decide what is better for that. Each mode has advantages and disadvantages. The statement-based replication is nice because you pass as little data as possible. It has drawbacks because sometimes it's difficult to pass the SQL statement and makes slave exactly the same as a master. SQL could be interpreted differently, and there are other reasons why the state of the slave almost always will be a little bit different than the state of the master. Binary log is a file. With a file, you usually write sequentially. And it is nice to write into file sequentially because sequential writing is much faster than the random writing. That what makes our replication more efficient and easy for the master. But we know that on the master, not all queries executed sequentially, not at all. So there is a way to sequentialize them somehow. And on the slave, those queries will not be executed the way as they have been executed on the master. That's why you might have some differences. So now we're going further, and we see master returned to the client, committed the query, everything is fine. And now what we can do? Now there is a time to introduce slave. And once you introduce slave, you see that the slave is designed much more complex than the master. In master, comparing with a non-replicated node, you have just binary logs, and that's it. Binary logs and index file. So two additional files. On the slave, you have four, twice more. That's very important. You have relay log, which contains essentially almost like a binary log, but on the slave side. You have relay logs and you have relay log index, the same like on the binary log index. And also, there are two files, master info and relay log info. I will talk about that in details, but I would like to tell you that essentially those two files keep track of replication coordinates. Here we will see how it is done. Replication starts command, start slave, and with this command, the special thread on the slave starts. And that thread goes to the master and kind of tells master, look, there is a slave over there. And what master supposed to do? You will see. Master starts another thread, which is a dumb thread, and that thread, it essentially reads binary log and sends events from binary log into IO thread. I would like to tell you that in the binary log, transactions stored not like SQL statement, but in a little bit modified way as events. It is not very different from SQL statement. The only important difference that now they have numbers associated with that. One of the very important numbers is a number of the master server. Master server has a number. Without that number, replication will not work. You must to set it up. And that number essentially tags every transaction which is sent to the slave. So slave knows from which master that SQL statement came from and can distinguish that. So if you have a circular replication, for example, the slave will not perform the same transaction twice because, oh, I already saw that. And now IO thread, once received transaction from the dump thread, it stores it into relay log. Once it stores it into relay log, it updates master info parameters. Oh, now I read that event from binary log. Actually, that's what essentially IO thread says. The number 12 essentially updates the master info file and increase the counter of read events. Now we can do execution. So on the slave, we start SQL threads, which finally reads relay log and tries to execute those transactions on the slave. And once the transaction of the slave is executed, it updates the last one relay log info file and says, now we executed that transaction. That's where we are now. That is the explanation of coordinate-based replication. Where are the coordinates? We will see them. If you look at the directory of master and slave, and this is 5.5 directories, you will see binary log on the master. That's what it is. And you see index log on the slave. You see also relay log, and you see those two guys, relay log info and master info, which tracks the master, and the relay log info tracks the slave. And here you see the index file, which keeps track of the relay log indexes. And that's what you see, the content of the index file on the master, and here the context on the slave. And here how events actually are located in the binary log. I didn't put the number here, but the number is just in front of every event here. You see, begin, there is a transactional group, the events group essentially organized into groups, and you commit for each group. So let's go further, and here how replication data files work. You see master info, and you see the position in the binary log. What is interesting that that file is on the slave, not on the master. But it shows the position of the what was read on the binary log on the master. And here you also see the position, what is on the slave, relay log position, that where it is positioned on the relay log, and also where the location of the event which was executed, but in the binary log coordinates. So you see quite a bit of coordinates. I wrote explanation for different coordinates, like master binary log name. You can see all of these items in the show slave status, show master status, depends on what particular item you're looking for. And here there is a master binary log position. There is a position in the master binary log where IO thread read to. And here that's where it executed, because execution could be later than what IO thread read. And in the slave relay log, you have only one position, you know, that was executed, nothing else. What else it could be over there?
I have a question.
Yeah.
I mean, is this kind of coordinate replication applicable in the situation of a multi-master replication, right, like Galera?
First, I'm not sure that Galera uses coordinate-based replication.
Okay.
Actually, I believe they use GTID-based replication, which I'm going to talk about. You can work with this coordinate-based replication, and a lot of people did. The only problem that it is easy to set up, so it is great, but it is bad because it's difficult to fail over. And you understand why? Because once you have multiple slaves, when you switch from master to another slave, and that slave becomes a new master, where from the last slave, coordinates are on the new master. And it's a pain in the neck. It's really not easy to do. And unfortunately, when failover happened, you don't have much time, you know, to play with these things. And it's difficult to try, you know, does it work or not. You really want to fix it, and that's it. And forget about that. It means that when the master fails, the slaves are ready to replace it, but the process of failure detection and acting upon that in case of multiple service requires significant DBA intervention. And difficult to follow changes through the complex replication stream that go to multiple servers. So how to improve it? And that's what I really like. If every transaction has its own global unique identifier, it became a lot easier to track changes. Because that number identifier will be on all servers in the cluster. And that makes much easier to do that. So it is possible to identify transactions uniquely across the replication servers. Also makes automation of failover much easier. And that's what essentially Oracle or MySQL guys did. There is no need to do calculations, inspect binary log, and so on. Just execute the command master auto position equals one, and that's it. Application level, it's also easier to do write and read split. And that is interesting, because application essentially could figure out which transaction has been already on the slave. That's kind of unusual thing. I kind of didn't think about that. And also, it is easy to develop new automation tools, which also MySQL guys did. Drawbacks. Additional complexity, but we engineers don't afraid of that. But the real drawback is incompatibility with existing coordinate replication. So you have to have either one. And moreover, once you moved to GTID-based replication, you cannot go back because the protocol is different. And you have to think about that.
You can go back, but you have to like shut down both servers.
Oh, yes,
sure
you can.
You're writing to both and then restart it with the new and then...
Right.
It's not impossible, but you wouldn't want to do it with your production system.
Right. And you can, of course, do that with MySQL dump, all these things. But it is... pain in the neck. Frankly speaking, I believe the new stuff is good. So once you kind of committed yourself, go ahead. So how GTID-based replication works and where those GTIDs come from? And that's important thing. Look, this is also directory. Now it's a data directory. You remember we had before 5.5. In 5.6, you have additional stuff, ata.cnf. And that file contains only one line. And this is a UUID of that master. So it's a unique 128-bit identifier, which cannot be in that cluster group. It will not be, for sure. You can manually delete that file, and if you restart your server, it will be generated again, automatically. If you didn't delete it, if it exists, even if you restart the server, it still exists. So it's fine, it's very nice, very reliable. So this is only one part of GTID. 128-bit identification number server UUID and logically identifies the server where the transaction was originated. Every server has its own server UUID, slave and master. If you delete it, it will be regenerated, and GTID is written in the binary log. And the second part of GTID is a transaction identifier, 64-bit transaction identification number, which is incremented with every new transaction. It starts with one, there is no zero. And that's how they are in the binary log. You see, that's green color transactional group. They inserted that before. What is interesting, when you use tools to watch a binary log, you will see those numbers. Yes, Paula?
It's not the same as the LSM, the PIN.
No, it's completely different. It's absolutely different. And moreover, you can play with that number. That feature completely orthogonal to coordinate base replication.
Isn't log sequence number for unary only? Logs? Yeah, so it can't be.
Of course it can. Right.
Yep.
So I'm just curious, why 128-bit for the servers, of which there are going to be fewer servers usually, than the number of transactions that occur on a server? So you only have 64 bits for the transaction ID.
Right.
But 128 bits to identify a server. I mean, you would expect a larger number for the number of not more bits for the transaction ID than for the server ID.
The problem is that it depends on which set you consider when you're talking about those numbers. When you're talking about transaction numbers, it's essentially transactions within cluster. But when you're talking with UUIDs, people who design that stuff, they didn't know what cluster you are going to invent. That is why, for the purpose of uniqueness, there is significant redundancy in 128. I agree with you. I bet there is a combination here of time and IP something, and that's what creates a relatively large number here. First, 128 UUIDs is a relatively standard thing.
Right.
We know that. So it was not accidental. Also, compatibility with existing standards, which makes a lot of sense, and I think it's the right thing to do.
Is a transaction ID allowed to wrap around?
In what sense?
Like once you hit the max on the transaction ID, does it go back to 1 again?
You know,
theoretically speaking. Once you hit that 64 bits.
I don't think, I never heard that somebody discussed that. I never heard that. I doubt that you really, if, for example, you execute transaction in maybe in 1 nanosecond, you probably need about maybe 100 years to just, with the current computers, to get that number.
So I think the answer is you'll upgrade to different hardware and have a different UUID with different transaction numbers before that happens.
Yeah. I remember I tried to represent like nanoseconds from 1970, and that fit into 64-bit quite well. So, and how to configure GTID replication? What is the difference in configuration? And you see, MySQL guys added GTID mode. Definitely you need to tell server, is it coordinate-based or it's GTID-based? You now obligated to have binary log on the slave and on the master, on both. I usually do that because it makes a lot of sense. Also, you have to enable log slave update, so those binary logs supposed to be updated, definitely. Very important thing, enforce GTID consistency. This is a trap. What it means that whole GTID stuff works only for transactional tables. It does not work for non-transactional tables. Doesn't work for MySum, and non-transactional statements are denied by the slave, of course. You know, most of people use DB tables, maybe some other, like docutector tables, which are also transactional. So it kind of works. And here also you see the line, which is different now comparing with the old coordinate replication command, change master to master host. Now instead of binary log file name and position, we have just master out of position equals one. And here, if you run show slave status command, you see new things, master UUID, also you see received GTID set and executed GTID set. That's how you essentially started to count transactions one by one. And that's wonderful. GTID replication basic. Each server has binary log, master and slave. GTIDs are written to binary log. GTIDs executed on the server contains a new read-only global server variable. It's a variable which contains all GTID executed. And GTID execute holds the range of GTIDs committed on this server as a string. So essentially that's what it is. You have one long string. That string made a lot of people uncomfortable. Look, I executed 12 million transactions. How I supposed to keep that string? Because the key is range. When you execute your transactions, you execute in most cases one by one. So the range is very easy. Even 1 million transaction, it's just a few characters. 1-1 million, and that's it. Not a lot. That's what you see, the binary log, the database server UUID. You have transaction increasing. This transaction came from another guy. So multi-master, exactly. This from the same guy, this from another guy. So we have two masters, which is nice, I believe. Now you have everything what to recognize. Yep.
So the order in which the two masters are entered in the binary log doesn't matter?
Yeah, it doesn't matter. You're just saying that from this master I've done this set, and from that master I've done that set.
Right.
So you have 17 different ones. The order doesn't matter because it remembers what it's done and what it hasn't. So now your question is, what happens if I now fail over to another slave? Where does it look? Well, it looks in the binary log for anything that's not in that range. It will apply things not in that range, even if it's before something.
Yep, that's a key. Because now you can get things which was before, and that's what actually I use in my demo.
That's not right, it's a consistency
issue. Right. Oh, not really.
No, because the binary logs tell you exactly which transactions have been done and which haven't. With coordinate-based, you're assuming that when you start from this position, this log, you're assuming you've done everything before it, and you haven't done anything after it.
A transaction can have conditionals.
Sure, but have you ever failed over a server and then the first thing you had to do is skip just a few transactions that were duplicate and then it's at the right place?
Yep.
That doesn't happen here.
Right.
Because it knows what it executed and what it didn't. And so if it does two transactions and then comes across something that's already applied, it just skips it for you.
Yeah. Important thing, and what I like really about that replication, it based on some math. Because GTID set possesses both cardinal and ordinal properties. With ordinal properties, you know what's inside. You have two sets. And once you compare them, you know what's in one, what's not in another, and vice versa. You know that. But in addition to that, because of the transactional IDs, now you can order them. What was before and what was after. And that both things really key. That's what I really like. So the GTIDs could be compared and sorted at the same time. That's why it works kind of well. So, and those properties define very powerful model for tracking transactions. So what's interesting here, look, we have master and slave. And we selected a GTID executed. On the master, we have 1 million transactions. On the slave, we have 99,999. And with this way, we can figure out very easily one transaction is missing and which one. That's very good. So we have new replication protocol. When slave connects to the master, it sends to the master the range of GTIDs that slave already executed and committed. So the compactness of the GTID presentation is very important here, you understand. You don't want to send even 1 million GTIDs. But with ranges, it is relatively small. And in response, the master sends all other transactions, those now real transactions, that the slave has not yet executed.
Jacob,
Are
those row-based or are those statement-based, what it sends?
Depends on what mode you have. Yeah, it could be either, yeah. Or with a mixed, it will be mixed. The command, change master to master auto position, and if you use auto position equals one, you cannot specify master log file and master log position, obvious. Yeah, they report about error. So sorry?
Where would you specify anything other than a one in the master auto position? It seems like all the time you're specifying master auto position is a one, right? Is that right?
When you use GTID based, yes.
But is there a situation where you would use something else?
No, because you no longer use coordinates.
I'm wondering why that.
Because it's implicitly set to zero when you're using coordinate based. So if you do, if you're in MySQL 5.6 and you do a show slave status and you're using regular coordinate based,
well, yeah, that's what
it'll say. Master auto position equals zero. But no, there's no reason for you to actually physically set it.
Okay.
It's just an implicit thing.
Because you still can. Yeah, yeah. You still can use coordinate based replication in 5.6. It's 100% compatible. And that's where the problem actually happens. I would call it, you know, there are compilation bugs, there are runtime bugs, and there are design bugs. And here, it is not really a good idea, logically, you also understand that. Probably in 5.6, they should prohibit coordinate-based replication altogether, completely, to allow two very different replication run on the same server, not at the same moment, but at least brings a problem. And the problem is that you still have that server ID from coordinate-based replication, and it's still part of the transaction. And if you didn't put it in, it will be the slave will complain and said, sorry, I cannot perform that. Even logically, it is not needed, absolutely. But what it means is that when you have other situations, you take advantage of new GTIDs, but old server ID could stand in a way. That are kind of unfortunate, but that's how it is. They probably are going to fix it, maybe in 5.7. Coordinate replication failover. And now master failed, and you want your slave to point to another slave. For example, that slave to use this slave one as a master. Each slave has a different state. Some of them could be quite far ahead, some of them not so far. So you have to figure out what the new master already executed and how relative to the new master your slave which you're looking for is located. So it's really pain in the neck. If you go to GTID replication failover, you just said out of position, and that's problem of the master and slave to figure it out, not yours, which is really very good, easy and error-free. And that, it really works that way, which is really nice and wonderful. So now I'm going to talk a little bit more about how to create high availability architecture based on Amazon Cloud Services. And here a little bit words of how Amazon Clouds are designed. You see, the way to create high availability architecture is to duplicate your sites. So you want to have your site in multiple availability zones, because one availability zone could go down, and you want to replicate it to another one. And Amazon provides you with that. Moreover, they recommend even for high availability to have your database server replicated in three availability zones. So it is very, very reliable. Here, the different AWS components to use, and as a nodes, Amazon uses so-called instances. Each instance have directly attached disk, which they call ephemeral storage, which is quite fast, but if you stop your server, the content of the disk disappears. If it crashes, it doesn't disappear when server comes back. But if you just stop it, it disappears. Also, you can use RDS, which is a relational database servers, and it essentially represents EC2 instance, which stores the data on EBS, Elastic Block Service, which is essentially kind of network type of storage. It is relatively fast, but not as fast as ephemeral directly attached storage. Also, if your availability zone goes down, it could take a lot of time for you to recover your data if you use EBS. Because at that time, everybody on that availability zone went down and everybody wants to recover. So that availability zone will be overwhelmed by the number of requests, and you have to wait until kind of those data will be gradually available. And another thing, the last one is S3, which is a very reliable storage, but quite slow. You really cannot keep database over there. It's just files which you use essentially like backup, that type of thing. This is probability of the failures for these different components and what to do if the failure happened. For example, S3 failure is very, very low probability. I didn't put the numbers here. EBS zone failure is medium. Usually Amazon has about 3-4 failures for availability zone per year. And that kind of not pleasant, but it's difficult because even sometimes it is not Amazon fault, but could be disasters, could be huge hurricanes, could be earthquakes. It's difficult to predict what might happen in this case. What we have to do in order to provide high availability? We essentially have to have multiple nodes and replicate from one node to another one. In our case, because we don't want to use EBS because it's not so reliable, and most important, it is not so fast. We have very stringent requirements on latencies. We use ephemeral storage. But with ephemeral storage, if somebody stopped the server, you lost your data, so you have almost constantly back it up. Now we have another problem. Our application really does not like to be stopped. If you, for example, manage physical devices, right, you don't want those physical devices to stop. So what to do? So we created an additional snap slave, which runs on the same server and doesn't take very much resources and replicates from the master to the snap slave. And you can stop snap slave for like some time. If you use volume managers, or even better, if you use ZFS for operating system for your storage, the snapshot usually takes about 10-15 seconds. You have to make your database, they call it special word, quiescent. In MySQL, it realizes with flash table with read lock. That is the command. And after that, you unlock the table. Once you're done, and everything is fine. So for this, when you do that snapshot, remove all writing by that command, and you can safely do snapshots, and after that, you're done. And the same design exists on the slave, big slave. And here, that settings for the configuration. I would like to pay attention that master info repository equals tables, and relay info repository equals table. What it means is that now we're talking about crash safe binary log and relay log. Before, when I had my wonderful picture with flying pieces, I showed you the files MySQL info and relay log, and they were files in the directory. Once you have files, it's difficult to have transactionality. How you manage that? No way. But why not to put those data updates just in the table? It could be in a DB table, and it's not difficult to provide transactionality in this case. And that's what essentially MySQL guys did. And now you can have transactionality, so your info will be updated only if the writing in the log was successful. And that's good. So that is a new feature in the replication, and that's a very nice feature. So we have a ZFS snapshot for master and slave backups. We must have slave node to make ZFS snapshots because of the stop. And master server cannot stop without stopping all warehouse system. That's the reason. And there are different failover cases for that system. Essentially, there is a service failure, like master process failed, slave process failed, and you have to move your application to another server. You have node failure when the whole node went down. Now you have to move all that stuff into second node. Again, this is a simplified version what we have. Could be network failures now, but by network failures, I mean not the network between application and the master. Because if that network failed, it's fine. Kind of, you cannot get to the master what you can do. But in Amazon, it could be worse situation when you have a network failure between nodes. So application work wonderfully, but there is no replication. And that you have to figure it out, and you have to do something about it. And essentially, you're switching to another node and trying to restore replication. Here, presentation. So we have application, which runs on node 3. We have node 1, which runs master and runs snap slave on node 1. And also, we have node 2, which runs slave. So what we're going to do? We're going to run application. Master will replicate to the snap slave and will replicate to the node 2. After some time, master is going to fail. Essentially, we're going to kill it. And we will redirect application to the node 2. What is interesting, that we will make master as a new slave of new master on node 2. Now master will replicate, new master will replicate to the old master, new slave, and at the end, we will have the same number of rows on the new master and new slave. What's important, that how to create new slave. What we wanted to do, we wanted to have snapshot from the snap slave, move it into master directory. Because it's nice, it's almost the same. So we're saving a lot on slave can catch up. You see initial conditions, checking the snapshot if it exists, clean up the servers. After that, we start the servers, set up GTID-based replication from master to snap, set up GTID replication from master to main slave, and initialize and start local application, the data. After that, we prepare to take snapshots of the snap server, flush tables with read log, take snapshots and unlock tables on the snap server. After that, we will crash the master, crash application, and promote new slave, main slave to the new master, and restart application to point to the new master. Yeah, and this is very interesting.
Thank you.